Hello, everybody. Hello, everybody. Welcome to Thursday, June the 18th. So great to see you. Wow, I'm all out of the camera here. How is everybody? Let me scoot the camera around just a little tiny bit. Guess I should have checked that. How is everybody doing? I think that's a little bit better. Hello, everybody. It's so great to see you. I've been reading along in the comments. Those of you who were here early, I feel like I told my mom a little bit ago, I feel like I've done a high school term paper for this video. I have so much information to share with you. So much information. So glad to see you. I've been reading all of the comments. I've been here a little bit early. So great to see everybody. Thanks for joining in today. I just want to let you know that if you're watching this on the replay, see the little message right here? I will be putting timestamps this evening, so if you're watching this on the replay, you can go to the description box and see all the different timestamps that I'll add, because I have so much information. You might want to just hear some like bullet points of today's video. You might want to skip around. If you're here on the replay, hello. I mean, if you're here on the live, hello. So great to see everybody. Wow. On my channel, I teach a lot about t-shirt quilts, right? Hold on 1 second. I should have done this before the live. I teach a lot about t-shirt quilts, how to make them, stabilize your t-shirts. I've talked about my favorite interfacings in a lot of the videos, tips for doing binding on t-shirt quilts, all kinds of how to center your logos and stuff like that. And many of you have found my channel by watching my t-shirt quilt videos, right? A lot of you subscribed after watching my countertop video. Thanks for subscribing. Today, we're going to be talking about the great interfacing shortage of 2020. That's what we're talking about today. How's everybody doing? I see that my comments are not refreshing, so give me just a second. I'm going to try to re-pull up this video. Dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun. There we go. There's more comments. Hopefully that all is working. There we go. Wow, it's so great to see everybody. Cheryl, I was so glad to see your comment on my video the other day and get an update from you. It's so great to hear from you. Sherry, thank you so much for moderating my live chat. You're at the office. So, it's so great to see everybody. I'm just scrolling through all the comments that I missed. Dawn, you're doing some packing. You're doing some packing. Yeah, moving is a lot of work, isn't it? Yay, my comments are working now. Just letting you know, if you're on the live and your comments aren't moving, try going out of the video and coming back in. It worked for me just now. So yeah, today I'm going to be going over tons of stuff. I'm going to talk again about my favorite interfacing for making t-shirt quilts. Y'all, there are tons and tons of interfacings out there. My favorite is what I'm going to show you. It's a Pellon product, but you know, there are tons of other brands of interfacing as well. We're mainly going to be talking about the Pellon products today. I'm going to give you a list of some other interfacings that you can use in your t-shirt quilts. We're going to talk a little bit about the recent shortage that everyone is experiencing. Y'all, I get inundated here on YouTube with questions, and in my Etsy shop, people send me questions, and on Facebook and emails all over the place from several different sources. Because y'all are experiencing the same issues, trying to find interfacing for your t-shirts. Now, t-shirt quilts. There's lots and lots of quilters out there who just started making t-shirt quilts. You know, we've all been quarantined at home. What better time to start learning how to make a t-shirt quilt, right? Being shut in the house, but you're facing some issues when it comes to finding interfacing. Then there's the t-shirt quilters who make them for family and friends. You've made them before. And then there's people like me who make t-shirt quilts on commission as part of their business. And so this greatly impacts the bottom line on my business. And so we're all in different categories on that spectrum that I just mentioned. So it affects us all differently, but we have one common denominator, right? There's a great big shortage. So we're going to talk about that. And then I'm going to show you some of the notions that I like to use when making t-shirt quilts and how you can incorporate a few different methods and tips for making a t-shirt quilt without interfacing. Yes, you can do that. You can do that. You can make t-shirt quilts without interfacing. We're going to talk about some pros and cons of interfacing with t-shirt quilts. It's going to be a huge mind dump. I have like 4 pages of notes. I'm going to do some demonstrations at the end. All of this in today's video. Just reading through the comments. Linda says, my grandson passed away yesterday. Oh my goodness, leaving 3 children. This sounded like might be perfect to make the family if they want to part with his t-shirts. I am so, so sorry, Linda. I'll be praying for you and his family and his children. Oh my goodness, that is very sad and tragic news. So I hate to hear that. Hopefully you will find some information in today's video helpful, especially if you're going to be making quilts from his clothing. I'm hoping that today some of the tips that I share with you will be a blessing. So, so sorry to hear that. Well, yeah, so many people are still quarantined, right? We're going to be talking about some of the reasons why there's a huge lack of interfacing. And y'all, it's not just with the quilting world, it's widespread interfacing. Bag makers are having the same problems us quilt makers are having. So that's interesting, right? So yeah, I've wanted to give just an intro to what today's video is going to be about. Again, if you're watching on the replay, I'll put all the timestamps down in the description box. It'll be later this evening when I do that. And yes, we're going to go ahead and just jump right in. Ramona says, I'm stuck on a t-shirt quilt that I'm trying to make. I cut them all different sizes and now I'm stuck. Ramona. Ramona, sorry, y'all. This is the first time I'm talking today, really. And I always have a morning voice when we do the lives. On my video, on my channel, I have several videos about doing collage style quilts, like the one you see behind me. All of those blocks are different sizes. So I have several different series that you might find helpful here on my channel about doing quilts that have different sizes. And I have a quilt grid set that I use to help me plan, and it does all the math for me because that's the part I get stuck on. It does all the math for me. And so I'm able to do, let me see if I can scoot out of the way. All of those blocks are different sizes. So you might find those series really helpful. Okay, y'all, I'm going to switch on over now. I'm going to switch over to my laptop screen because I'm going to start sharing some information. Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. So I'm over here now. Ooh, you can see the quilt behind me a little bit better from this angle. So, first things first. I called Pellon. I actually talked to them yesterday. She was so friendly, y'all. She was so nice. So, I'll talk a little bit about that conversation here in just a second. But I actually talked to Pellon yesterday. So I can relay some information directly from Pellon in today's video. But first things first, and so many of the people who write to me and ask me questions, they ask me, can you make a t-shirt quilt without interfacing? And the answer is yes, okay? There's pros and cons to using interfacing in your t-shirt quilts. We're going to talk about that. And then the second question that people often ask me is, what is your favorite interfacing to use for t-shirt quilts? So we're going to go ahead and get started with that. My camping trip was awesome. Oh, it was so relaxing. It was so relaxing. Can you use sweater fabric for quilts? Kathy, I have oftentimes used sweaters in quilts with my favorite interfacing on the back. What about using batting that is fusible? Ramona, you might be able to do that. I have not tried it. So there are lots of methods out there that I have not tried. You have fusible fleece. That might work. I don't know. I haven't tried it. So I would say, you know, experiment with it. Purchase a little bit if you can find it and take some scraps of t-shirts and just do some experimenting to see if it works or not. All right, to answer the question, what is your favorite interfacing for t-shirt quilts? I'm going to pull this up on the screen. My favorite is the Pellon P44F Lightweight Fusible Interfacing. It is a non-woven white 100% polyester interfacing. It's ultra light and best to use with light to medium weight fabrics. I do put it on sweatshirts and sweaters, and it works great. I also use it on the backside of sports jerseys and those neoprene shirts. You know, the real silky type of shirts. I just lower the temp on my heat press or my iron, okay? So one of the things I want to show you, and I'm not going to be able to keep up with the comments for a second because I want to focus on what we're doing here. And then as soon as we're done here, if you have questions for me, hold on a second and then type them in all caps, and that'll make it really easy for me to see. So the information box with the interfacing, that is directly off of the Pellon website. That tells you what P44 is and the information and specs about it. And then I went over to Joann's because that's where I usually purchase it from, or Amazon, which my distributor on Amazon has been sold out for about 3 months. Okay, I just happened to buy 3 bolts of it before the great big shutdown of everything, not knowing, because I have a business that uses it and I keep it on hand anyway. So luckily I have, let's see, a bolt and a half left right at this minute. But sometimes I do buy it from Joann's. I have a Joann's about 20 minutes away from me. So I pulled this off of the website, and the normal price, the normal retail price of P44F at Joann's without a coupon is 99 cents a yard. So that's a really great price, even if you don't have a coupon, right? I like to say in all my videos, if you have a coupon, you can bring that price down to like 50 cents a yard, right? Sometimes if you have one of those really great coupons, like 75% off, you can get it for like 40 cents a yard, right? And I like to buy it a bolt at a time, and a bolt of this at Joann's has 48 yards. So if you bought a bolt of this from Joann's normal retail price, you're looking at about 50 bucks. If you use a coupon on it and save at least half off, you're looking at about 25 bucks for a bolt, 48 yards, of Pellon P44F. Now, this little snapshot from Joann's was taken yesterday. I want you to notice underneath the price in the yard box and the shipping, there's a little gray box that says not available at this store. I'm in Williamsburg, Virginia. It has said not available for several weeks now. I'm always having conversations over on Facebook, here on YouTube, and people send me updates. So this might vary. Joann's might vary from store to store. I actually have 3 Joann fabric stores within an hour from me. So I could get to the one in Williamsburg in about 20 minutes, the one in Newport News in about 25 minutes, and the one in Hampton in about 35 minutes. I could drive from store to store if I had the time to do that, to search this down. I get reports from people who say they don't see it available on their website, but when they actually go to the retail store, they have some, but they limit you. You can get 3 yards at a time. If you have a t-shirt quilt to do and you need 20 yards, how many trips to Joann's will it take at 3 yards a trip, if they even have it one of the times you go, right? So these are the dilemmas that we're facing. This is my favorite. This is my go-to interfacing for t-shirt quilts, okay? I also have used Pellon 911 FF Fusible Featherweight. Okay, so I'm going to pull this up on the screen. And I'm only going to be talking about these two specifically because these are the two that I use in my t-shirt quilts. The 911 is sort of like a backup for me. Okay, I'd much rather prefer to use the 44F. Look at the price difference for first. Pellon 911 is $3.99. That's the normal retail. So we're already jumping up $3. Let's just pretend we don't have coupons today, right? We're already jumping up $3 a yard, right? So if you're making a t-shirt quilt on commission where, you know, your profit is affected by the cost of your goods, I'm already taking a huge cut on interfacing, right? So let's go over the specs about the 911 FF. It is also non-woven. It comes in charcoal, gray, or white. I've never seen it in the gray at Joann's, but supposedly they make it. It's also 100% polyester. It's 20 inches wide, the same as the 44F. Featherweight, fusible interfacing, used with light to mid-weight fabrics. And so the main difference that I notice between the two interfacings is the 911 FF is a little bit thicker, has more body than the 44F. Okay, so those are the main differences besides the price. $3 more a yard for this one. Also note, on the Joann's website clip, underneath of shipping, it says not available at this store. Right? Just gonna see if I have any questions. Will SF101 work? I'm gonna talk about that here in just a second, Linda. Helen, you say I'm breaking up really bad. Try leaving the YouTube and coming back into the video. Maybe that will fix it. Dawn asked, how about making your own interfacing using fusible web and a light cotton? You can do that. However, it's going to add a lot of weight. It's going to add a lot of weight to your t-shirt, but you can try it. Plus the cost of like heat and bond, if that's what you're talking about using, something like that, fusible web, that stuff is expensive too. That stuff is expensive too. So how much is your t-shirt quilt going to cost then? All right, so there's 44F and here's 911 FF. I've had many people ask me, how about the SF101? So I did the information on that too. We're going to talk about 906 towards the end of the video, Peggy, because I got some information from Pellon directly. So we'll talk about that here in just a minute. SF101 ShapeFlex from Pellon is an interfacing that you could use. However, it is extremely much thicker than the 911 and the 44F. Mainly, the ShapeFlex, the SF101, is really designed for things like shirt collars, yokes of the shirts, for areas where you're going to add buttons, like on your cuffs. It talks about all of the details in your garments that you can use the shape flex right here in the description. Again, this is from Pellon. This is woven. It is 100% cotton. It comes in white and black. It is a fusible interfacing, but I want you to note, provides crisp support. That's one of the bullet points on ShapeFlex. When I think of crisp support, I'm thinking like this instead of flowy like this, right? So it does affect the drape and the softness and probably the weight of your t-shirt quilt. I also thought it was interesting. See, I've never used the SF101 in my quilts, but I thought it was kind of interesting when it says on the screen to pre-shrink, fill a sink with warm water and place the interfacing in water for about 10 minutes. And I'm like, wow. I wonder if everyone knows to do that. And if you don't do that, does it mess up your quilt once you wash it? I don't know. See, these are things that I have not experienced because I do not use the SF101. Also, I want you to note on the Joann website, the price difference. Again, we're jumping up $3 more a yard, $6.99 for this interfacing. Can you imagine doing 30 shirts? You can probably get two blocks from 1 yard. So that would mean if you have 30 shirts in your quilt, you need 15 yards. What's 15 times $7? That's a lot of money just to add interfacing to the backside of your shirts. And then they're going to be a little bit stiffer and heavier, right? And if you're making your quilt on a domestic machine and you're trying to quilt your quilt on a domestic machine, imagine the issues that you might run into. Anitra says she's only used the SF101. So there you go. She gets it on a larger bolt from Walmart. So yeah, maybe price shopping. But Miss Anitra, how is the drape and the flow of your t-shirt quilts? Is it stiffer? See, I don't know. I've not used it, but I pulled up the information because so many people have asked me about the SF101. And I will tell you, after reading the specs on it, I probably would not use it for a t-shirt quilt, mainly based on the price. But again, seeing all the specs, I'm a creature of habit. I stick to products that I know and have good experiences with. So we're all different. Deanna once says, how about the June Taylor's t-shirt interfacing? I have not used it, so I'm not sure. I've heard lots of people say that they've used it and they had great results. I personally have not used it. Amy makes a great point. She said she uses the SF101 for making bags. So it provides great support and durability to your bag, right? When you use it in the construction of bag making, I read tons and tons of Etsy boards. Bag makers are also experiencing shortages on interfacing for making bags. All right, so there's the information on SF101, okay? So now I've shown you the price, the 44F normal retail price, and we're using Joann's as a baseline, right? 99 cents a yard. The 911 was $3.99 a yard, and this SF101 is $6.99 a yard, okay? So in the last couple of months, soon as people started sending me messages about having a hard time trying to find interfacing for their quilts, I've been doing, okay, so where can we find interfacing? I buy mine at Joann's or on Amazon. So I go to Amazon and I go to my normal person that I buy from, on Amazon and they're sold out. And I'm like, holy moly. Okay, so they're sold. They've never been sold out before. And no estimation of when they're getting any back. I was like, okay. So then began my great search. And I've been searching. I've posted on Lisa Cape and Quilts on Facebook a couple weeks ago some search results that I found, which blew my mind. And as of yesterday, I did some searching so I could post some pictures on this video. So let me show you some of the prices that I found now that we've gone through normal retail prices, right? So let me show you this one on Amazon that I found yesterday. Pellon 911, which at Joann's, remember it was $3.99 a yard. A yard on Amazon for the same interfacing is now $12.95 plus $3.99 shipping a yard. That's crazy to me. That's like $8 more, right? Well, they say you can save 7%. You can save 7% if you buy right now. Because it normally is $13.95, right? You see all that information on the screen. That I cannot make quilts on commission with that kind of pricing. I just cannot. I cannot do it. So this is the 911. This is typically my backup interfacing. If when I go to restock, I can't find 944F, Pellon 911 is my backup for t-shirt quilts. So, you know, I would pass on this listing. I wouldn't be able to do that. The next listing on Amazon that I found yesterday, and this one doesn't even have a brand name. It just says white, medium weight, fusible interfacing by the yard, $10 a yard. That's still, I cannot make a quilt. I cannot charge enough for my t-shirt quilts in my area to justify paying $10 a yard for interfacing. I can't do it, and I can't raise my prices because I'm already, right now, for 2020, I'm kind of at the highest end of people in my area who make t-shirt quilts. People just can't pay that. People have been furloughed and out of work and businesses are closing. They cannot afford to pay me anymore currently, right now, for this year, for a t-shirt quilt. I can't take a loss on the interfacing, not at $10 a yard. I can't do it. And I don't even know who made this. They don't tell you in the listing when you check around. It kind of looks like 44F, but I'm not sure. So $10 a yard. Then I went over and jumped on Etsy. So here is the first listing. Again, this one doesn't say the brand name. It does say made in the USA, but this interfacing looks totally different and it looks thicker. I don't know. But it says 60 inches, lightweight, fusible interfacing, $8.69 a yard. So it's a little bit wider, $8.69. But I don't know any more information about this. They don't tell you a brand name. You can't tell exactly how heavy it is, and I've never used it, so I would be a little leery. Dun, dun, dun. Here's another listing. Here's some fusible 906, which someone asked me about. We're going to talk about here in a little bit. Here's one on Etsy from Mask to You. That's the shop name. They're selling it at $4.95 a yard. Sorry, I was just reading that. You save 55%. You save 10%. If you buy it now, $4.95 a yard, that's the cheapest that we've found so far, right? Online as of yesterday. Here's another one I found on Etsy yesterday. White, non-woven, lightweight, Pellon, fusible interfacing. Well, there are several lightweight ones. I don't know which one this is. It kind of looks like the 44F, but it doesn't specifically say that. It's 60 inches wide. You get 5 yards for $27.49. So I did the math. That's $5.49 a yard. It looks like 44F, which is typically 99 cents a yard, right? That's a lot more than 99 cents a yard for Pellon P44F. I'm looking at the picture. That's what it looks like to me. $5.49, but that's the cheapest so far. And I know I'm missing lots of comments. I'll come back to them here in just a second. So y'all can have conversation with each other. Just know that while I'm focusing here on the laptop, I cannot see your comments for a minute. Here's one from, I think this was like 2 weeks ago. I posted this and I know it's fuzzy because I took a cell phone picture of my computer. But I want you to focus on Pellon P44F for 1 yard at $6.99. This was also Etsy like 2 weeks ago, $6.99 a yard. That's a $6 increase on a yard of Pellon P44F. I can't do that either. I can't do that. Here's another one from Etsy. Was this Etsy? Yes, it's Etsy from like 2 weeks ago. 1 yard of Pellon P44F, plus they're going to throw in 1 yard of Pellon 911, $18. So that makes it $6 a yard for both. If you do the math and split the cost up, $6 a yard. Then I went over to eBay. 1 yard of Pellon P44 fusible interfacing is $14.99 a yard. $14.99 a yard. And look, that listing is getting viewed once per hour right now. What does that tell you? Lots of people are looking for it. I bet you lots and lots of people are paying this, right? We're going to talk about some of the reasons why here in just a minute. But yes, $14.99, that's a $14 increase a yard. I can't do that in my commission quilts either. And I know not everyone makes quilts on commission. Not everybody is doing that. Some of you just want to make a t-shirt quilt for somebody or yourself. Can you afford to do that? I don't know. We're all different. I cannot do that. Okay, so there's some current pricing. That's of yesterday, and then a couple of the last pictures were from 2 weeks ago, and I posted those on my Facebook page a couple weeks ago when I started realizing what is going on, right? What is happening? Oh, it's so great to see everybody. Hello, everybody. I'm just flipping through. If you have questions for me, if you put them in all caps, it's really easy for me to scroll through. Otherwise, I'm going to come back and read the big majority of the live chat this evening. Yes, if you know websites or places to go to get interfacing and you want to share that information with everybody, that would be so great. I mean, I really feel like we're a community and a family, really. And if I can help you, you know, sharing information. So if you are able to find it somewhere, that would be great. I do have some resources and places and directions to send you coming up here in just a minute. Susan, I am here in just a minute. I'm kind of working up to that and showing you why you might want to make a quilt without interfacing, right? Lack of supplies, cost of current supplies, supply and demand, all that stuff. You can use spray starch. We're going to talk about that here in a second. So yes, I have all these notes and I don't want to miss anything. Give me just a second. So yeah, let's just be real for a second. Making a t-shirt quilt using interfacing for me. Okay, I'm speaking from my experience and after making, wow, I've lost count now, tons and tons of t-shirt quilts, y'all. I find using interfacing, even though it costs more, it saves me so much time. And time is money, right? Time is money. If you are charging someone to make them a quilt, your time is worth money. Depending on what you charge, the more time you invest making the quilt, the less your profit is, right? Because your time is valuable and you should be paying yourself for the time. Many of you are just making quilts, not for money. And I understand that too, but you know, your time is worth something. I find it a lot easier to make a t-shirt quilt using interfacing. And that's me. It saves me so much time because when I first started making quilts, t-shirt quilts on commission, I thought I could make a little bit more profit if I didn't invest in stabilizer, right? Because, you know, you look at everything. You look at everything and I'm like, okay, so I could save, let's see, if it's 99 cents a yard and it takes me 15 yards, I could save 15 bucks. I'm going to show you some of the reasons why it's a little bit trickier to not use interfacing and why it might be more time consuming. It took me way longer. And the $15 I could have invested in stabilizer would have saved me several hours of fidgeting with t-shirts without it, right? So then I transitioned into using interfacing on every single quilt and really saving me a lot of time. But yes, you can make t-shirt quilts without it. And we're going to show you some tips here in just a little bit. So let's talk about why there might be a shortage, right? Because I've never experienced this. My business, let's see, 2015, I got my business license. We're in 2020, that's 5 years. I have never experienced a shortage in any of my materials anywhere until this year. And going into this new year, I had really high expectations of my business. And this has really thrown me for a loop. And so, you know, I'm not the only one. I'm not even complaining about it because so many people have things so much worse, right? But this is how it affects me, and it might be affecting you too. But let's talk about some of the reasons why this is happening. If you go to YouTube, and in the search box of YouTube, don't even type in the M word. Type in interfacing shortage. And then scroll through the videos that it recommends to you. And the only two words you've typed in is interfacing shortage. A bunch of mask videos pop up, right? Tons and tons and tons of them. That right there tells you that a lot of people are using interfacing, making masks, right? There's a huge supply, huge demand for it. People are using it and bolts and bolts and bolts of it. And who would have thought going into this year that stores and distributors should have stocked up because this was going to happen? Matter of fact, even in the beginning of the quarantine, they were telling you not to wear a mask. And I ordered the last bolt that I ordered off of Amazon, I was able to order right at the very beginning, right at the end of February. Now they've been sold out for 3 months. So that is a huge, huge factor, making the mask. But then reading boards on Etsy, it's not just the interfacings that people are using to make masks, right? There are also shortages on interfacings like the SF101 that a lot of the bag makers make. There are tons of boards over on Etsy talking about how even their stiffer, more firmer interfacings, there's a shortage of. So that led me to think that maybe there's an issue at the source, right? And I'm just talking about Pellon products. I'm not talking about the June Taylors or any of the other t-shirt interfacings that you can use in your t-shirt quilts. I'm talking about Pellon because that's what I use and that's what I recommend in my videos. So I called Pellon yesterday. Oh, she was so nice. Okay, so I called at 10:30 in the morning and you get the voice recording that says they're open from 9 to 4 Eastern Standard Time. It was 10:30. And the recording said that there was no one available to take my call, leave a message. So I did. I left a message. And then a few hours went by, and I was like, you know what? I'm just going to call them one more time. And I did. And she picked up. And she was so friendly, y'all. She was so friendly. We had a really great conversation. And I just asked her lots and lots of questions, right? I'm going to share a lot of that information with you in today's video here in just a minute. Different interfacings that they recommend for t-shirt quilts. And let me take this off the screen because I'm going to be sharing some other stuff. So from the source, from Pellon, in my conversation with her, she told me that they are located in Florida, okay, where Pellon is made and where it is shipped to their distributors. That's all done in Florida. Well, Florida is only in phase two. And as of yesterday, because of positive cases increasing over the last week, even though they're in phase two, they are restricting and closing down a few more stores because of, I almost put down the wrong finger, because of more positive cases, right? So even though they're in phase two and stuff has started opening up, they're now starting to close some of the stores back. And that's just from what she told me yesterday, okay? But because they're in phase two, they are so understaffed. They have lots of parents who work at that plant, and they have small kids. Summer camps are closed, which their kids would usually go to camp during the day, or daycare. Those are all closed, so there's no child care. The parents aren't coming to work. Other members of their staff aren't coming to work. They are super, super short-staffed. And then, not only on that end, distribution, right? Trying to ship this stuff out, what very little is made right now, they are hugely, hugely backordered. Not only on products, but on emails. If you've emailed them, they're answering a first come, first serve, and you might be in the list of 400 people down, and they're going short-staffed email by email. And so they're backlogged on shipping. Although they are shipping every day, it is super backlogged to their distributors. Super, super short-staffed. And don't see that changing. That's the big news. They do not see that changing anytime soon. So what does that mean for us? That means even longer of delays, right? They're still making it. They're still shipping it, but it's not at a normal rate that would sustain such a huge demand, right? It's just not. So yeah, they're super backlogged on orders. I want to make sure that I say everything from our conversation. She was so nice, y'all. She was so nice. She did give me a list of usable interfacings. I'm going to share that with you. Dun, dun, dun. I want to make sure I got all the points. I want to thank you, all of my moderators, for moderating my chat. Pellon is located in Florida. Dun, dun, dun. Going through, checking to see if we have any questions before we move on. Dun, 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 dun. All right, hold on one second. Mama Moose says, Lisa, you have not been through a pandemic before. Nope. Nope, I have not. All right, so let me pull up the next slide. Just trying to keep on task. So I showed you the increased prices online. I also want to show you, I went over to fabric.com yesterday to see if I could buy any from them. They do carry lots and lots and lots of fusible interfacings. But if you notice right on the screen, underneath of each title of the interfacing, it says not available for purchase, not available for purchase. Matter of fact, all of the interfacings yesterday said not available for purchase. I know you can't read that, but right underneath of the type of fusible it is, in those small little letters, it says not available for purchase. So yesterday, fabric.com did not have any in stock. But that doesn't mean that tomorrow they won't get a shipment and have some. So my suggestion is check back and check back often. You know, check back this morning, check back in the afternoon. And do that daily, because this is all changing day to day and everywhere that you can buy it. even Joann's. Today, they'll say they don't have any, but they might have a shipment. And tomorrow, they might have 3 yards that you can go get. So those are some of the things that we are experiencing. Yesterday, when I was talking to Pellon on the phone, these are the interfacings. I said, okay, so if I can't find my two favorites, the 44F, and I can't find the 911, what are some other Pellon interfacings that you recommend for t-shirt quilts? And she was so friendly, y'all. She went through and she gave me this list, the 44F, 906, 911, 931, 950. And then she said, you can also let them know about the 820 and the 821, even though that is gridded. So if you're using it on a white or a light yellow t-shirt, you might be able to see that grid through the back. It doesn't wash off. But last case scenario, if you really, really need it, you might want to write down those two interfacings. They're fusible and you can sew through them. And she said they work for t-shirt quilts. I can't tell you what they're made of. I didn't do the research on most of those. But you can go to the Pellon website and they give you all the information, all the specs about each one of the different types of interfacings. Okay? And then she said, you can let them also know that they can go to PellonProjects.com. I've put a link in the description box below for you if you want to just click on that. When you go to PellonProjects.com, you will see a little tab that says Helpful Tips. You click on that, and then you'll see a new menu pop up, and it says Where to Purchase. If you click on that, it's going to give you a whole list of distributors, Joann's, Hobby Lobby, several other clickable links to distributors that carry Pellon products. And she said they are shipping daily. It's just not where it needs to be, and rightfully so. But the distributors are getting shipments. You'll have to check with them because Pellon does not do any direct sales. If you go to the Pellon website and you look for a little shopping cart, you cannot buy directly from them. They work through their distributors. So that's where you can find a list to distributors that you can contact on a daily basis. And maybe even if one of them is nice enough, say, hey, my name is so-and-so. I really need a bolt of this. When you get it in, can you call me and save it for me? And I will purchase it as soon as you call me. You know, something like that. I don't know if maybe they're willing to work with you. I don't know. PellonProjects.com. That is where you can find a list of people who carry the Pellon products other than Joann's and Amazon and all the other online sites that are selling it at some crazy prices, some of them. And so if you want to stick with distributors, that's where you can find a list for that. It's so great to see everybody. Just know I'm not going to be able to keep up with the comments. I'll have to read everything later. And sometimes I feel like I'm missing so much conversation, but I have fun reading it later. If you do have questions for me though, put them in all caps. It makes it a little bit easier. So I think that is everything I wanted to share with you. So hopefully you were able to write down this list. If you're making t-shirt quilts and you can't find interfacing and you want to know what else can I use besides the 44F, these are my recommendations. This is what was recommended. I haven't tried all of them. Only the 44F and the 911. The 906, 931, 950, and the two gridded ones I have not tried before. I just want to be really clear about that, but that's what was recommended to me by Pellon. Yeah, I need to take a breath. That was a lot of mind-dumping information, right? It's great that you can come back on the replay and, like, pause it if you need to, right? Okay, so now let's just dive into, before we get to the really good stuff, why you're here maybe, let's dip into some more of the pros and cons. I feel like I'm out of the view. Here we go. More of the pros and cons. Okay. Time is money. Interfacing adds some cost, some material cost into the construction of your quilt, right? So if you're sewing on a budget or you're making a quilt on commission, you do have to look at that. What is the cost of the goods going into your quilt? However, time is money. So it saves you time in the sewing of your t-shirts, quilts though, right? So even though there's a little bit of an investment in the interfacing, if you can find it at normal prices, the time it saves you is so valuable. I don't know what your hourly rate is, but I know what mine is. And if it takes me 3 more hours total to put together this quilt top because I don't use interfacing, then I'm actually losing money, right? I'm actually losing money by trying to save a little bit in the interfacing. But let me tell you, my accuracy is so much more precise when I use interfacing. I'm going to show you examples of what a t-shirt block looks like with interfacing and without interfacing here in just a minute. However, the more that you do a t-shirt quilt without interfacing, then the more used to it you get, right? I'm kind of spoiled now to where I like the control the interfacing gives me, and I can breeze through a quilt top. I can make it really quick. If I'm fumbling with raw edges on t-shirt material that's not stabilized, then that's going to take me a little bit longer. So I'm going to show some tips that'll help you with that. Let's see. I'm just looking at my notes. So some of the pros and cons of interfacing in your t-shirt quilt is the weight. So 944F weighs hardly anything. I have a bolt of it right here, or what's left of this bolt. And look how light that is. It's so drapeable and light. It hardly adds any weight to my quilt. Okay, so I don't mind using this one. That's one of the reasons why I like this one so much. Not to mention the cost of it, right? But it's super light. The 911 is a little bit heavier, but not much. If you use a really, really thick interfacing, which I've done before, a little bit thicker than the 911, then it does, if you've got 30 shirts with that on the back of them, it adds some weight to your quilt, right? If you do a t-shirt quilt without interfacing, it is softer, it is more snuggly, it is lighter, okay? So those are some of the pros of doing it without the interfacing. It is way more softer and more cuddly. I've noticed that even if I'm using the lightest stuff on my t-shirts, it still adds a little bit of body. It's still cuddly, but it's not the same as you making a t-shirt quilt without it, right? So these are all things you have to weigh. Do you want it really cuddly and soft? Do you want a little bit more control when you're sewing it together? Let's see. Da, 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 da. You have to be really careful when you're making a t-shirt quilt top that does not have interfacing because it is stretchy. It is still stretchy. The seams can stretch. You might pop a seam. You also have a little bit harder time getting control when you're basting your quilt and trying to keep those rows straight, right? The interfacing adds a little body, makes it a little bit easier to control when basting your quilt, or even if you have a long arm and you're loading a t-shirt quilt, you'll notice the difference of one that has interfacing. You have more control trying to get it situated, loading it, right? Versus a t-shirt quilt that doesn't have it and you're fumbling trying to get it straight on the frame. Pros and cons, things you have to think about. You can do both, but those are the issues that you're going to face, right? Peggy asks, what can we use in place of the stabilizer? Well, you can do it without it. You can make a t-shirt quilt without interfacing. You don't have to have it. And I'm going to show you some of the things that if you go that route might be helpful to you. I'm going to just share some tips that were helpful to me before I started using interfacing in my t-shirt quilts. Dun, dun, dun. Let me check my notes. I don't want to miss anything, and I took all these notes. Yeah, I think that is a good starting list of pros and cons. You know, why it's easier with it, but why you might want to consider not using it. And to be really honest, after talking with Pellon yesterday, I don't think it's going to get any easier to find anytime soon. Soon meaning like the summer months, at least. I don't know that they're going to be getting it where you can easily buy a bolt of it if you have a couple t-shirt quilts coming up. Not in the next couple months. So that's one of the reasons why I not only wanted to talk about the shortage of the interfacing and give you a list of some of the other interfacings that are recommended, but to show you some tips and to let you know that you might want to start practicing with some scraps without interfacing and maybe start getting really creative with the way we make our t-shirt quilts, right? And not use it at all. And because I don't see the shortage coming to an end anytime soon. Let me just make sure I showed you all of that. Dun, dun, dun. So now let's get to some even better stuff, right? Rhonda asks, can you put the interfacing on the edges of the blocks only? You could do that. You could do that, but I'm going to tell you, you'll notice a difference. You'll notice a difference in your quilt. One block that only has interfacing around the edge of it so that you can cut it and sew it to the other blocks relatively easy. The inside of your t-shirt is going to drape, and you might have some fullness when you actually go to quilt that quilt. Not 100% sure, but I think you're going to be able to tell a difference if you do that. All right, so let's go into some of the notions. So let's say I just got an order for a t-shirt quilt, and I know I don't have enough interfacing to do all of them. I'm going to make the t-shirt quilt without interfacing. Okay, let's just pretend we're making a t-shirt quilt. Let me show you some of the stuff that I'm going to use for making this t-shirt quilt without interfacing. Let me switch this over. There we go. There's my notes. All right, I can't put them too far away because I have to check, keep myself on point here. So let's talk about the thread. What thread do I like to use for my t-shirt quilts? Even if I'm making a quilt without interfacing currently, and in the last year and a half, this has been my go-to thread for piecing and quilting. You actually find this on Amazon. It's from AK Trading Company. I've put a link if you want to check them out. It is in the description box. But when you purchase this spool has 1,000 yards on it. You get 4 of these. They're all the same color. They have many different colors. $18.95 on Amazon. So you get 4 of these. And they have all the different colors. This is 100% spun polyester. It does not say the weight on here. However, I use it for piecing and for quilting on my long arm. Okay, so if you read the description about this thread, it is for domestic machines and high-speed sergers and long arms. So, yeah, it's my favorite thread. Plus, you can't really beat the price, and you can get it in just about every color. So, this is what I use for sewing together my t-shirt quilt top and for quilting and for putting on the binding. Will stay stitching work for making t-shirt quilt blocks? That is a good question. I've never tried, Miss Anitra. If you know the answer to Anitra's question, that would be great if you typed it in. All right, so there's my thread. My needles, my favorite needle, if I have them. See, I need to get more. These are the Smith's Jersey needles. They come in 3 different sizes. There's these 1070, the 1280, and the 1490. Out of those sizes, the most common ones I use, you'll see the 1280, both of those needles. One's in my machine now, and the other one got replaced. So those are my favorite needles to use, the 1280 or the 8012 Smith's Jersey needles. But I have a backup, so if you don't have these on hand or you can't order them or find them, I also use these needles, also by Smith's. They're the universal needles, and this pack comes in several different sizes too. But again, I normally start with the 8012 or the 1280. I forget which number you're supposed to say first, but that's the size that I start with. If you're sewing lots of sweatshirts in your t-shirt quilt, then you might want to bump up the size to the 1490-14. And if your t-shirts are on the thin side, you know, a lot of t-shirts they make these days, you can almost see through them, right? And even with an interfacing, it is still thin. Then you might want to go down to the smaller size, the 7010. But generally, I stay in the 8012 size range with my needles. And I have a Juki sewing machine, and these also worked in my Singer patchwork. So, my most favorite, my backup. These are the needles that are primarily always in my sewing machine, unless I'm doing something totally different, right? I do lots of glue basting. You might have seen some of my glue basting videos. This is my favorite right now, all-time glue. You can also use Elmer's school glue. It has like a chalkboard on the front. You can use both of them. The main reason I switched over to the Elmer's glue all is because it's this extra strong formula. It really bonds the t-shirts really, really well when you're glue basting, and it's stronger. It still washes out of your quilts, but it's a little bit of a stronger hold. Have you ever glue basted two t-shirt seams together, and by the time you move it from the pressing board over to your sewing machine, it pops open because the glue for some reason won't stick to those t-shirts? That happens. Maybe the mom washed them in fabric softener or something. I don't know. This, I have less of those issues, right? It's a little bit stronger and it does wash out. So the Elmer's glue all I use, and especially when I'm doing t-shirt quilts without interfacing. I'm going to show you the difference in pinning your seams and glue basting your seams here in just a minute. And then someone asked about starch, and I don't have my favorite in front of me. My favorite starch is Stay Flow. It's in a great big blue bottle, and you can find it at Walmart. And you mix it to different levels of strength, right? So you can make it really concentrated, or you can water it down. But it is probably my favorite, mainly because I can mix it really strong and the cost of it. Cost-wise, I love it. But this is my second runner-up, the Niagara Original Spray Starch. Spray starching your t-shirts is so helpful. That is such a great tip to share with you. If you're going to make a t-shirt quilt without interfacing, spend some time starching. Which is going to add some time to the amount of time you're putting into your quilt. So, I mean, it's something to consider. But spray starching will help. To get your t-shirt completely stiff, like if you were using interfacing, that not only would take so much starch, it would take so many different times of starching it and pressing it, starching and pressing it. It would take a long time to do every one of your shirts that way. Okay, but it does help to give a couple sprays and to press it into your t-shirts before you begin. I just don't know that it would be cost effective to starch it so much that it acts like it has interfacing. So those are my main go-to products when using, it's all upside down. There we go. Starch, my needles, my thread, and glue basting. Okay, and then you're pretty much set up and ready to make a t-shirt quilt, right? Dun, dun, dun. I have some more examples to show you. So great to see everybody. Ooh, that took a lot of talking. Give me 1 second. Dun, dun, dun. Ooh, I already have a thumbs down. Thank you so much. Thanks. What was the first starch name? Stayflow, S-T-A-Y. And then there's a little dash, flow, F-L-O, I think is how it's spelled. And I find mine at Walmart, but I've seen it online too. So let's take a look. These are two t-shirt quilt blocks cut exactly the same size. This one actually goes to the quilt you see behind me. I just pulled it off the wall for demonstration purposes. So this one has interfacing on it and this one doesn't, same shirt. So when I am working with a t-shirt quilt block that has interfacing on it, I want you to see the body. This is the 44F, so it still has a lot of drape to it, right? Still very light. But watch this, when I put it on the board, all of my raw edges stay nice and flat and crisp and pretty. See that? I can move it all around like this, like that. I can pick it up and put it down, and there it is. That's my t-shirt block. So if I'm going to pin this to the next one, if I'm sewing the seam to the next block, it's really easy to work with, right? Still very light though, but I have a lot more control of this block as I'm cutting it out and as I'm sewing it in my quilt. So here's the next block, same size. When you spin her around on your mat, see that? I'm just flipping with my fingers just like that. You have a lot less control of the t-shirt block as you're working with it. Then if you do, even if you add the lightest interfacing to it, right? And then if you're picking it up and you're moving it around, your little edges curl up. I picked the wrong color t-shirt to use for this video because you don't see that. But the edges are curled up, right? When you're cutting everything out, you have to be really careful. Now it is possible, and I did it. This is a block cut out without interfacing. I cut it out exactly the same size as the other one. So it is very well possible to cut an accurate block without interfacing. It's just working with it afterward that you really have to get used to, right? I mean, it doesn't take much to pick up the shirt, to put it down, you know, spread it out flat. I like to tappy, tappy, tappy those edges, make them lay flat. But then pinning it to the next block takes a little bit of time, or even glue basting. Okay, and so when I pick this block up, it's a t-shirt, no interfacing, versus the support of interfacing. So you see that? More control, no control, right? It takes a lot more manual manipulation to work with a t-shirt quilt block that doesn't have interfacing, but you see it is possible, right? It is possible. So next I'm going to show you not only two different ways to make that seam, pinning and glue basting. I'm also going to show you two different stitches that you can do with your domestic machine to sew these together, and one might be more helpful to you than the others. But I'm going to give you some tips on how to do that and not make a mess with your seam if you're making this type of quilt, no interfacing. Okay, so I'm going to give you some tips on that. So much to share. So much to share. Let's see. Let's bring over the pinning. We're going to pin some t-shirts together that have no interfacing. Right, and I'm going to show you an example. These are sewn together. These are sewn together. See, if you just tappy, tappy, tappy on your board, They lay somewhat flat. Maybe not exactly. All right, so no interfacing. This one was done with a straight stitch on my domestic machine. And this one was done with an overlocking stitch on my machine. I'm going to show you that here in just a minute and tell you some reasons why this one might be even stronger for this type of quilt without interfacing. But the first two pieces we're going to pin together, okay? We're going to pin these together, and I'm going to show you what it's like to work with t-shirts that have no interfacing on them. I'm just going to unline those up. I'll keep those lined up to make it faster. So here's a t-shirt. We're going to pretend that this is a whole block, but I'm just using strips so that we can move through it faster. We're going to pretend like we're pinning our blocks together. I'm just working through the process so that you can see some of the issues that you might face when doing this type of quilt. You have very little control, especially if your blocks are bigger, like, you know, a good 12-inch block, 12 by 12, or even bigger, 14 or 16 by 16, you know, those big quilt blocks that you might do with a t-shirt quilt. You're working with a much larger piece. I'm not saying it's impossible. I'm showing you that it is possible. I just want you to see what you might be dealing with if you make that quilt without interfacing. Not impossible, but my number one tip is to have patience, because it's going to take a little bit longer, right? It took me that time just to line up this raw edge. We're going to go ahead and throw some pins in here. So there's a pin. There's a pin, and I'm going to tell you what, when I'm sewing t-shirt pieces together that are not interfaced, I use lots of pins because I don't trust that the bottom fabric has not scooted over, right? So I pin a lot, which takes a little bit more time. And I'm just throwing pins in there. But this is how many I would use, like that, and then like that. And I sometimes even like to throw a pin in the middle of my block. Let's pretend that this is the middle, just to keep that middle from not moving. You might want to feel more comfortable pinning several places to keep those fabrics together, right? So there's my seam we're going to sew. You see how flexible it is. I'm going to pin this one together too. Let me think. We'll do the straight stitch on that one. And let's do the other one. Oh, no. Let me think for a second. We might be doing double more work. Yeah, I think we could do that. I'm sorry. I think I was going to make more work for myself than what was actually needed. So that is pinning. I'll bring up some different colors so we can keep track of what's what. Here's two more t-shirts without interfacing. We're going to glue baste this seam. Okay, so we just saw pinning the seam, right? Hazel wants to know, do you ever use the Wonder Clips? I use it for my binding, but I don't usually use it for keeping my pieces together when I'm bringing it over to the sewing machine. I know lots of people do, though. I prefer glue basting, and that's what I'm going to show you here now. It's my preferred method. Pinning, oh, it takes me forever to pin. So we're just going to move that off to the side for a second because I want to bring my pressing board over. So one of the things you'll notice on my pressing board, besides the green paint from last week's live video, that's just paint, y'all. is that this is flannel. This is a flannel pillowcase covering a wood board. That's my pressing board. I do have a video on my channel about how I made my pressing board, but usually my pressing board has cotton, 100% cotton fabric, and that's what usually covers my board. However, if you're going to be working with t-shirt quilts without interfacing, you're going to find it really helpful if you cover your pressing board or your iron with flannel. And this is just a flannel pillowcase with the board inside. What happens when you're working on flannel and the t-shirts is you have a little bit more control of the bottom fabric, right? That flannel just kind of holds it in place for you, which is lovely. See that? Nice and flat. So at least this bottom fabric is not going to shift and move around, right? Which is really nice when you're pressing your seams on these t-shirt quilts, is having flannel on your pressing board, 100% flannel. And then it kind of holds that, and you can make that seam straight before you press it. It's like little grabby fingers, right? So I'm heating up my iron to the highest cotton setting. Bye, Miss Jan. Thank you so much for hanging out with us this morning in California. Right? Isn't that such a cool tie-dye shirt? She has a couple of those in her t-shirt. This was just for the extra. It was like a long sleeve, and it's just an extra piece from the sleeve. So I'm just waking up my iron. Come on, you can do it. My favorite method is glue basting my seams because it gives me so much more control at the sewing machine. You're going to see how I actually save time when I'm sewing these seams together, having it glue basted versus pin basted. So you're going to see that here in just a second too. So I do not even put a continuous line. You can if you want. I'm just putting a few dots of glue right close to that edge. And this glue will be in your seam allowance. If you're using a 1/4 inch seam allowance like I do, the glue is still in the seam allowance. If you use too much, it will seep, but it washes out. It does wash out. So I just applied little dots of glue. You can see them there on the camera. And I'm going to lay down the pretty side. Actually, both sides look the same. Right on that raw edge. See how very little control you have of the t-shirt material when it's not interfaced. It's just one of those things you're going to have to get used to. This is how I did a good portion of my quilts before I actually started using interfacing. So I know it takes lots of patience. I'm just doing little tappy taps right there. Those raw edges are lined up, and then I have a pressing cloth, okay? And if you're glue basting, you most certainly want to cover that raw edge in case the glue doesn't go this way, it comes out. You don't want to get that on your iron. You might get it on your pressing fabric, your pressing board fabric, but this is a pillowcase. I can slide it off and throw it in the wash, right? So I'm just going to cover the t-shirts and protect my iron because those are a pain to have to clean, right? And now I'm just going to glue baste and dry that glue. Miss Peggy, this is the Elmer's glue all. However, I also like using Elmer's school glue, the glue that has like a chalkboard on the front. This is the Elmer's glue all. It has a little bit of a stronger hold on the t-shirt material. And I've pretty much switched over to this one. However, school glue works as, you know, as well too. This one's just a little bit stronger. I do have the steam set on my iron. My iron actually heats up a lot more when I turn the steam on. I know a lot of people don't put steam in their iron at all. So you would just dry this with a dry iron. But if you're like me, and time is money, I go a little bit faster and I throw some steam on there and dry that glue on the seam. So here is our two pretend blocks, t-shirt blocks. You can see I'm moving this all around. It is perfectly lined up on both sides. A nice secure bond all the way from edge to hedge. And I have a little bit more control of this edge not curling once I've glue basted that, right? See that seam like that? And this one with the pins, the fabric wants to curl over like that, right? If you're just holding it like this, the weight of the pins, it does curl it over. So there you go. Teresa, nope, I do not have any issues with the glue gumming up the needle, and that's because we just dried the glue. It's dry. There's no wet glue in this, so you're not bringing any wet glue over to your sewing machine. And once it's dry, you can sew through that. You sew through thicker stuff if you use, the heat and bond light. That's thicker than the amount of glue that I just put down dots in that seam allowance, right? You want to make sure it's in the seam allowance, but even if it seeps through the line where you're going to sew, it's okay. You can sew through it. But it's all dry. And it does not gum up my needle. I've never had an issue with glue gumming up my needle, glue basting either t-shirt quilts or my regular patchwork pieces. All right, so that's glue basting. And this is pinning. So now we're going to talk about the two different seams that I use when piecing together t-shirt quilt tops that do not have interfacing. But just see that? See that control now on this edge versus the pinning? That's why this is my favorite. So next, we're going to actually sew these seams together. But I want to show you the straight stitch and an overlocking stitch. Both stitches can be done. Let me move my little cherry tomatoes out of the way. Y'all notice cherry tomatoes and not candy? I'm trying to make better choices in life. That's me trying to be healthy. Cherry tomatoes. All right, both of these can be done on your domestic sewing machine. However, if you have a serger, I'm pretty sure it's easier to use your serger. I don't know. We're going to talk a little bit about these two stitches. All right. The straight stitch. Dun, dun, dun. What happened? Oh, here we go. I have notes for everything. Dun, 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 dun. Let's see, I was reading comments and then I lost my places. Yeah, cherry tomatoes. That's what I was gonna do. I was gonna take a sip of water. I talked to several quilt making businesses. The one that I actually bought my long arm from, they make t-shirt quilts on commission. They do not use interfacing on their t-shirts. And they use a serger to piece their quilts together, which I thought was interesting. I don't have a serger, so I don't have any experience with that. But that's how they piece together their t-shirt quilts on commission. So, and they say it saves them a lot of time. I don't have a serger, but I do have an overlocking stitch. So let's talk about some of the pros and cons of these two stitches when you use them in your t-shirt quilts. For one, the straight stitch on my machine, which goes pretty quick, is so much faster just doing a straight stitch versus an overlocking stitch. However, when I look at a t-shirt quilt top that's pieced together without interfacing, I immediately think, how strong are the seams, right? Because there's no support on the t-shirts. The only support you're going to get from your quilt at this point is from the quilting And then you're relying on the strengthness of your seam, which the thread that I use is very, very strong. So I'm okay doing a straight stitch, right? I trust my thread to withstand the use of pulling on this quilt without very little support, right? I trust that. However, when you look over here at the overlocking stitch, it not only has that straight stitch on the seam, right? It's also binding together both of those t-shirts with the extra stitching on the raw edge, right? That is so well bonded together. I kind of think that this might last over the years. If someone's going to use their quilt like every day and take it on picnics and stuff, and they want it to last and last and last and last, and you're not using interfacing, this might be a stitch to at least experiment and see what you think. Anitra, I did not ask them if they starched their shirts before they used their serger to put them together. I never asked them, so I could not say for sure. I imagine they might starch them at least once, you know, when they're initially pressing the shirt, you know, do a couple squirts of starch on it and then go to town working. So this kind of makes me feel like the seam is stronger. They both look the same from the front. Okay. They both look exactly the same from the front. And that's because the overlocking stitch that I use looks like this on your machine. It has that straight stitch. That is the seam that is going to show on the front of your t-shirt quilt, right? Nice straight seam. There's no separation there. I have seen people bring me quilt tops where they pieced them together with a zigzag stitch. And so when you go to your machine and you want to experiment sewing your t-shirt blocks together with an overlocking stitch, this is what I want you to avoid. Any of your settings on your machine that just look like a zigzag line, right? You're gonna look for on your machine, and they're pretty standard machine to machine, a stitch that looks like this. It's got a straight dotted line, but then it also has the little V's. This is the line that's going to show on the front side of your quilt. If you use a zigzag stitch to sew your blocks together, you're going to have little openings and little gaps that'll open up on your block. So avoid the zigzag stitch, but you might want to try out this overlocking stitch. Because look how much support that I think that it gives to those two seams. This takes a lot longer sitting at your machine when you're sewing the seam. It does. It takes a lot longer. The straight stitch is so much faster. So much faster. And now I remember why I had two more example pieces. I knew there was a reason for that. I knew there was a reason. I'm going to do two with an overlocking stitch. One that is pinned and one that is glue basted, so you can see how they act to that stitch. And then I'm going to do two with a straight stitch, one pinned and one glue basted. So let me bring this back. We'll glue baste one more. Why not? We're just hanging out with friends today. So what do you think? While I get these two pieces glue basted and the next two pinned, that's going to take me a minute. Let me ask you a question. Have you made a t-shirt quilt without interfacing? Say yes. My glue is drying up on the little tip. They do make little tips that you can get to put on these glue bottles that disperse little tiny dots of glue or beads of glue or lines of glue with a lot more control, but I just used the standard tip on the glue bottle and put some dots of glue on there. Michelle, I think the only alternative to using interfacing is not using interfacing. And I'm showing some tips today. You might have to come back on the replay to see some tips for sewing your blocks together when not using interfacing. Miss Sonia, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your support. I appreciate that a lot. I'm just going to cover that. We're going to dry that glue. I knew there was a reason why I had two examples, because I really do want you to see what it's like to sew both seams, one pinned and one glue basted. So those are lined up. I'm going to throw some pins in there. Miss Anitra, I'd really love your feedback. If you ever find a different interfacing like some of the other ones I suggested, if you ever use it, then I would love your feedback of what you think a quilt, a t-shirt quilt made with the 101 and then with something else. And I would love to know your experiences between the two. I've never used Susan. Thank you, Susan. I've never used the 101 to make a t-shirt quilt, so I would love to know your thoughts on both. See, it takes me a good little while. I almost forgot about that. Takes me a good little while to throw some pins in there. I'm getting sidetracked, y'all. We just dry the glue, and it really doesn't take that long, Lisa. Pay attention. There we go. We'll let that cool off. Oh, Michelle said she used some thin muslin and spray basted the layers together. But then she said it was very heavy with the extra weight of the muslin. That's good to know. There we go. That one's pin basted. So we have two that are glue basted and two that are pinned. And I'm going to do a seam. Where did I put that? A seam for both. We're going to do a straight stitch first, and I'm going to go over some settings at your machine that you're going to find helpful when sewing these together, and then we're going to do two with an overlock stitch, right? Yes. Okay, that I knew there was a reason why I did that. Susan, you found it. We just talked about that the other day, Susan. I told you not to do that. But I appreciate you anyway. You're sneaky. And thank you, Miss Hazel. Teresa said, I could swear I smelled the hot iron. Yeah, I almost forgot about it. That's what happens when you're live. You get so distracted, or at least I do. Susan says, nope, I've never made a t-shirt quilt without interfacing. Creatively inspired by Denise says, I have been working on my first t-shirt quilt ever, and it's a t-shirt quilt. Whoa, your first quilt ever, and you jumped into t-shirts. We have several of those over on Creative Crew Group. Several of our members, our family members, their very first quilt is a t-shirt quilt. I've been so proud and just like so excited to follow along in their progress. Hopefully today, Miss Denise, I'm sharing some stuff that you might find helpful. If right now you are finding interfacing and it's not an issue for you, then you don't have to worry about all this, right? This is what many of us might be experiencing presently or in the future, if the interfacing shortage doesn't come to an end anytime soon. Monica says, I'm new to this. What's interfacing? Let me show you. Interfacing, you can come back, Miss Monica, and watch the replay because I'm going to show you some alternative different kinds of interfacing in this video as well. I've already shown that, but this is a fusible interfacing. If you make t-shirt quilts, you fuse it to the back side of your t-shirt before you even cut your block out, and it helps give support and control to your t-shirt while not only cutting your block, while piecing your quilt top together, and even control when you're trying to get this quilt layered, basted for the quilting, right? So this is a t-shirt without, and this is a t-shirt. Let me do it fair, grab it by the end. There we go. That's the difference. It just adds a little bit of support and crispness. See that raw edge? It's nice and clean. It stays like that. And I would say it's like adding 20 helping hands while you're making your quilt top. Barbara says, interfacing is gold. I know that's right. I did the math a couple weeks ago, and a bolt of 44F was going to cost like $78. I'm like, wow, I could sell that bolt up there for $78? Crazy. Just reading through some of your comments. We're getting ready to switch over to the sewing machine. I was also trying to hesitate for a minute and let that piece cool down before I bring it over to the sewing machine. Goodness. All right, so let's switch over. I showed you pin basting and glue basting, with my preferred method being the glue basting. It gives me a lot more control. We're going to switch over to the sewing machine. There's the bed of my sewing machine. So let's talk about some settings on your sewing machine. Where did I put my card? All sewing machines are completely different. Okay, I'm going to tell you the settings that I'm using on my sewing machine. So that might be a starting point for you. But all the settings depend on your actual t-shirts, because they might be a little different from mine, right? They depend on the thread you're using, the needle you're using, and your sewing machine, really, and how it reacts with the thread and all of that stuff. So I'm just going to tell you my settings, and know that when you sit down at your machine, you're going to have to experiment as well. And then write them down, right? For this thread, set it here, you know, tension, all of this stuff. I am using my AK Trading Company thread. I showed you that a little bit ago. I have in the 1280 Jersey needle. That is what's in my sewing machine. For t-shirt quilt blocks that have no interfacing, I like to set my top tension at a -1. Does not necessarily mean that that's your setting, but that's what I have on my machine. I am setting my stitch length at 2.8. You might have to play with that on your machine. And it's a straight stitch with a 1/4 inch seam allowance. Okay? That's for the straight stitch. That's where I start. And sometimes, depending on the t-shirts, you know, if you have some thicker t-shirts or if you have some that are thinner or a sweatshirt, you still might even have to adjust your settings for those shirts. It's all a game, but you tend to figure it out and make notes so that you don't forget. So let's start with the straight stitch. We'll start with the two pieces, our pretend blocks that I've pin basted, okay? 1/4 inch, 2.8, -1, and one more note. One more tip. If your sewing machine, hold on 1 second. If your sewing machine has a little dial, you're not going to really be able to see it from here, but on my Juki, right here towards the back, is a dial, and that is for pressure on your presser foot. I can't say that 3 times. It adjusts how much pressure the presser foot is actually applying onto your fabrics that you're sewing. So if you have a little pressure gauge on your sewing machine, then you might want to look at lowering your presser foot pressure. For mine, I like to do between a 3 and a 2, okay? The standard level is 5. So I lower the pressure of my presser foot. Some of the older machines have a little, it looks like a little screw on the top. Sometimes they're a little knob and you're always wondering, what is that for? Why is it there? It might be something that you can alter the pressure of your presser foot. So if you're making these t-shirt quilts without interfacing, you most definitely want to check to see if you can do that, if you can lower that. All right, so mine is set on a 3. So there's all of my settings. All right, we're just going to go ahead and sew this seam of my pinned pieces. And I'm not going to alter the way that I normally would sew this seam. I'm not speeding it up for video purposes or slowing down. This is just how fast I would go with these two pieces. And I don't like to hit those pins like I just did. So yeah, stopping and taking the pins out. Make sure that your stitches look nice and even. Make sure your t-shirts aren't curling up. If your tension is too high, it's going to look like this. It's going to look all curled in like a little ribbon. You want to make sure that the stitches are laying nice and flat as they come out. And I just kind of really babysit the whole seam all the way down. So you can see it's taking me a good little bit. All right, so there's the first one. That's pin basting. So that's how long it took me to sew that seam. You're welcome, Hazel. I'm just saying that's possibly what that could be for. I know a lot of the older machines have that little knob or a little screw. And if you turn it one way or another, it adjusts the pressure. Miss Anitra, I would love to help you and recommend a walking foot to you. However, I'm not going to because my experiences with walking foot is always the one that comes with the sewing machine. So my Singer Patchwork had a walking foot. I could not stand it. The Juki came with a walking foot, and I haven't even put that walking foot on my sewing machine because I didn't like the walking foot on my Singer. Now I'm just conditioned to sewing without it. Putting a walking foot on, for me, added more pressure to my seam, and I just did not like that. A lot of people like using their walking foot, though, so I'm not saying don't use it if you like it. I just don't have one that I would recommend. I'm sorry. All right, so that was the pin basting. We're going to bring over the glue basting seam now. You can see when you lay that down, it lays pretty flat, right? And this is how fast I would sew this seam if I'm working with a glue basted seam. You can see I'm moving it all around. It's not coming undone, and it is still perfectly lined up. I did not glue base the ends of this one, so I will stop and just line them up. There we go. All right, so there is glue basted and pinned. We're gonna set those aside. Now we're gonna show you the overlocking stitch. And then we'll come back once we're done with that. We're gonna take a look at those seams. But you saw how quickly I was able to go through the glue basted. And I felt more comfortable, like I was keeping a nice, accurate quarter inch seam allowance all the way from the beginning until the very end where it wasn't glue basted and I just quickly finished it. I had so much more control over that one. That's just me. All right, my settings for the overlocking stitch. I will be changing my foot. Let me show you the foot that I'm going to be using. It has a little, like a little lip on the bottom of the foot. And I know it's tiny. I don't know if this will be any better. Maybe. It's got a little lip on the bottom of the foot. This is the foot that my machine says to use for an overlocking stitch. Okay, so we're going to change our feet. There goes the standard foot of my sewing machine. That's the one I use for a quarter inch. And we're putting on the foot for an overlocking stitch. I still have the AK Trading Company thread in both the top and the bobbin. I am not changing my needle. It's the Jersey needle, the 1280. That's the needle I'm going to use. So on my machine, in case you just joined us, you're going to want to look for a stitch that looks like this one. It's got the straight dotted line and then the little V's that go to the right of the straight dotted line. You're going to look for a stitch that looks something like this on your machine. That's the stitch I'm using on my Juki. It is number 7. Again, I'm going to share these settings with you with the pretense that doesn't necessarily mean that these are your settings. This could be a good starting point for you, but all the variables that we just mentioned a minute ago are going to come into play. But I'll tell you what I'm using. So mine is a number 7 overlocking stitch. I have my top tension at a negative 1. Again, I'm keeping the pressure of my presser foot still at 3. So I've reduced that pressure. I am setting my width at a 5.0, which is the widest overlocking stitch, number 7 anyways, that my machine will do. And it's slightly smaller than a quarter of an inch. It's kind of like a scant quarter of an inch. It's not a true quarter of an inch. So keep that in mind. And I'm setting my stitch length at 3.0. So those are all my settings. All right, we're going to bring over the piece that is pinned. Deb, you could use a woven fusible. I'm thinking that you might have just came in just a few minutes ago, maybe. You'll have to go back. I give a list that Pellon recommends for t-shirt quilts, and some of those might be woven. All right, so we are ready to go. We're gonna do our overlocking stitch. I don't know about y'all, but I always like to start with a little leader. That's just me. Let me get that thread. I cut it too short. Dun, dun, dun. Go through there. Thank you. You can test out your overlocking stitch on a scrap to make sure that it's as wide as you want it to be, that the stitch length is good, and that your tension is good before you bring in your pieces. All right, we're going to go ahead and start with the two that are pin basted. With this foot, you just bring it up right to that little lip, and it rides right next to it all the way through. But this one does take a little bit longer. And it's moving like this, okay? So your non-stabilized t-shirt pieces, you'll see me dealing with it, are gonna curl up like an inchworm while you're feeding it through your seam. Although I think my opinion, this seam is much stronger. It really bonds those raw edges. It does take longer, and I have a little bit of a harder time because it does this motion. I have a harder time keeping a nice straight line with this stitch. So those are things to consider if you want to use this stitch. I was actually supposed to have the purple side up. You can kind of see that stitch forming right on the fabric coming out the other side. I'm having a hard time because even though I pinned it a lot, I feel like my maroon fabric is scooching over. So keep an eye on that. Almost to the end, we're almost there. All right, so that one was the one that was pin basted. I'm going to bring over my glue basted one. Here's my glue basted one, and I have to think about it a lot less. I just have to make sure that it's going as straight as possible. I don't know why I have a harder time keeping that straight doing this stitch versus a straight stitch. Maybe because I do a straight stitch every day, right? I don't know. With the glue basting, I don't have to worry that one fabric is slipping away from the other. They're completely lined up. Except at the end where I did not glue baste. So I'll just finish that really fast because I did not glue baste the very end where it draped off my presser board. Okay, so let me separate these and then I'm going to bring you back over. I gave you the settings for my machine and my thread and my needle for the straight stitch and the overlocking stitch. Dun, dun, dun. Let me bring you back over here. There we go. I'm going to bring this over one more time because I'm going to show you the benefits of adding some flannel fabric to your pressing board. Hazel, yes, that's the same thread. I use the same thread, the AK Trading Company thread. This same color, the same AK, that's what I have in the top and bottom bobbin that I did for the straight stitch and the overlocking stitch on both of these pieces. So there's our overlocking stitch and there's our straight stitch. Both are absolutely fine for your t-shirt quilts, whichever one you want to go with, even if you're not using interfacing. Yeah, if you have a serger, I think you're going to save so much time. I don't know for sure, like 100% sure, because I've never owned a serger. However, friends of mine that do t-shirt quilts on commission as a business, they use their serger without interfacing on their t-shirts, and they say that they, you know, that to them it's a lot easier, but I don't know for sure. Do you recommend flannel or cotton for the backing of your t-shirt quilts? I use both, Miss Rhonda. I use, let's see, cotton. I use bed sheets. I use flannel. I use fleece. I use minky. I've used other blankets before because that's what my client wanted to do. I've used all kinds of stuff, but my favorite, like preferred, if I'm doing a t-shirt quilt, I'm really hoping that my client picks like a fleece or not fleece. I've used fleece before. It's very thick and heavy, the one that I picked. Flannel or cotton. Those are my preferred ones to use, but I've used all kinds of backings. Cheryl asks, is that stronger thread? There's a link, Cheryl, in the description box. And so if you click on it, it's going to bring you over to a listing on Amazon so you can read about it. But this thread is made for not only domestic machines, but high speed, like industrial machines, like a serger or a long arm. And I use it in my domestic machine and my long arm. My Nolting loves this thread. With t-shirt quilts, and I quilt through the logos. So, yeah, I have very, very, very little thread breakage with this thread, and usually if it breaks, it's because I've set the tension incorrectly. It's usually user error. Susan says, I own one, and I've used the overlock stitch on a regular sewing machine, and there's no comparison. I imagine so, Miss Susan. And I can tell you this. I don't know how long the great big interfacing shortage will go. I don't know how long. But if it's going to extend into next year, I might be looking at purchasing an overlock machine for this very purpose. I do like the straight stitch, and on my machine it's so fast, it's much faster to do the straight stitch versus the overlocking stitch. But a lot of people are like me and they don't have the serger. So this is a good alternative, the overlocking stitch on your domestic sewing machine. I left a pin in there. All right, so I just want to show you one more thing that you might be dealing with. So I showed you both ways, pinning and glue basting your seams, a straight stitch and an overlocking stitch. And so you could see both of those. Both of them will work. So the flannel on your pressing board or your pressing table or ironing board, drape some flannel over it. It's going to grab your t-shirts without interfacing. Even if you're using interfacing, it's going to act like it's little fingers grabbing your fabric. And it's a lot easier to lay out your blocks when you're piecing rows together. And you have lots of seams you're pressing. It just acts like little helping hands. Just like that. And you can just sort of finger tap everything nice and straight. And it really just grabs it. If you're pressing on cotton, it'll work just as well. But it's going to slide, not as much as this, but it's still going to move a little bit. But you can certainly do it. But you see there's some movement with the flannel. It just grabs it and it's not moving and shifting anywhere. So that is a huge time saver right there. If you do that, throw some flannel on there. I'll show you the same thing with the overlocking stitch. Just kind of line it up and finger press it just like that, and it grabs it right on there. I'm going to give these two seams a press. If you're pressing and you got logos close to your seams, it's probably a good idea just to throw a pressing cloth over top of there. Jeannie, you can't post your comments? I'm just giving that a press. My iron actually fell asleep for a second, so it's got to warm back up. I'm just pressing those seams really quick. I'm actually picking up the iron slightly when I move. You don't want to stretch these out. These blocks, without interfacing, are more stretchier. You don't want to distort your blocks. So I am picking up the iron slightly when I move around. But here we go. So I just want to show you one last time that the straight stitch or the overlocking stitch, it looks the same from the front, right? So whichever way you want to go, whichever way is easiest for you and you feel more secure with, those are the two stitches that I would use. T-shirt quilts without interfacing. I want to make sure I'm not leaving anything out because I'm going to tell you I have like a 5-page report here. Does anybody have any questions for me? Let's see, I'm going to go through my notes. I'll change the camera over. So I just want one last time. There we go. There's two seams. So you can absolutely do it. You know, if it comes to a point where you've got a quilt for Christmas coming up and you need to get started on it, but you can't find any interfacing, you can absolutely do this. Yes, it takes longer. It does. It might be more frustrating. It might be. But it's absolutely doable, okay? Absolutely doable. And if all I can find is $10 a yard for interfacing, I'm not spending the extra money. I'm going this way, right? I might even look at getting a serger. I might even do that. I can't afford to pay $10, $8 when I'm used to paying 40 cents a yard, 40 cents with a coupon, right? Or online, my normal Amazon listing, that person, $25 for a bolt, and I don't even have to leave my house, right? So yeah, if I can't have those prices, then I'm not buying any, and that's just me. I can't afford to do that in my business. I'll be going in this direction, even though it takes a little bit longer and it's a little bit more frustrating, and I just want to pass that on. If you're extremely bummed that you can't find interface and you can't start your quilt, you can do it without it. Cheryl asks, can you use that kind of thread on a Brother machine? I don't see why not, Miss Cheryl. I use it when I first bought it and first started using it. I was using my Singer Patchwork, and then I changed over to my Juki, and it works great in both of those machines. I haven't tried it in my Brother. My Brother, I've had that machine since I was 12, so I don't hardly ever turn it on. I'm like saving it. I haven't tried sewing with that machine. It's 100% spun polyester. For $18, you get 4 yards. And so it's not like you're out tons and tons and tons of money. If you want to investigate it, you're going to get tons of thread. You're going to get 4 of these for like $18.95 or something like that. And it comes in all colors. So you can try it and see. I don't see why it wouldn't, though. Rhonda says she'd sell me her serger. You're all the way in Arizona. Wow, how hot is it there? Just making sure I'm not missing anything. Hazel said the chat keeps freezing. Let me go out and make sure that I don't have that same problem. Maybe Miss Hazel, try leaving the video and coming right back to see if that helps it at all. So let me switch over here so I can look at my notes and you don't have to see all of that. All of that scribble scrabble. Does the overlocked seam make quilting more difficult? Miss Mimsy, if you missed it, I just showed examples on four seams. I did two straight stitches, one pin basted, one glue basted, and then I did two overlocking seams, one pinned and one glue basted. You'll see the time difference and how long it took me to sew those seams, and you'll see what I dealt with while I was sewing them. I don't think it makes it any more difficult. I think it takes a little bit longer. But I get great results from both. Oh, Cheryl said, I don't like Joanne's brand. It keeps breaking the thread. I've never tried. I've always used, maybe it did come from Joanne's. I don't know. I bought it so long ago, and then I switched over YLI. Why was I having a tongue twister? YLI is the thread I've been using since I started my business. I highly recommend that too. It's a little bit pricier, but it's great thread. YLIUU thread. You can look up their website. But then a year and a half ago, I transitioned into the AK Trading Company, and I haven't looked back. Mimsy said, no, the seam. I showed that, too. It was earlier. But I talked about why I almost think that this is stronger over the years. If you're not using interfacing on your T-shirts, there's a lot more stretch that happens. It needs a little bit more support. I'm totally okay with the straight stitch. I feel confident in my thread. But there's not a lot of support without the interfacing. And I almost think that this will hold up over the years because you not only have that straight stitch on the inside of the block, but your two raw edges are sewn together, interlocking. That whole raw edge is secured together. So I almost think that this is stronger. It is also, it gives a little bit, right? It has stretch to it. So in the using of your quilt without lots of support, that seam is going to have some give to it. It's not going to break any threads over the years where this straight stitch, let me just hold it like I was, like that. The shirt is stretchy still without interfacing, but that thread doesn't want to stretch as much. There's a lot less give in that versus the part that doesn't have the stitching, right? So even though I would use a straight stitch in my quilts, I'm confident between my thread and the way I quilt my quilts, I'm going to be relying on the quilting to give this support, right? If you're not doing lots of quilting on your quilt, that I would almost highly suggest doing the overlocking, because I think, to me, it just seems like it would be more secure. Both are fine. And I think I just answered that. I'm asking about quilting after it's pieced. Yes, when it's all pieced together, I was just saying, you've got lots and lots of weight and lots of stretch. I'm thinking that's stronger when you quilt it. If you're going to take it to the long armor or you're doing an all-over stitch yourself, the more quilting in your quilt, the more secure it will be. If you're stitching in the ditch and that's the only stitching you're doing, or if you're tying it, I almost think that this is more secure, and that's just my opinion on it. Susan said, do you mean with a long armor, get upset if it hits that seam? Well, there's a lot of open material on that seam, y'all. It's not throwing tons and tons of thread in there. You can still stitch through that. I do on my null thing all the time. But, you know, maybe if you're concerned about that, call your long armor. They're all different. We all work differently. You know, some long armors don't take bed sheets as backing and some do. Some only use this batting ever. And some like me, whatever batting you want to use, we'll do it. If you bring it to me and I'm okay with it, if it's quality batting, I don't care if it's 80-20 or if it's all cotton. I'm good with all of that. Or polyester, I'm good with that. So check with your long armor. Tell her, hey, look, I saw someone using an overlocking stitch with their domestic sewing machine or even their serger. And is it okay if I do my seams like that? And piece of quilt top that's a t-shirt quilt that's not interfaced. Is it okay if I do that with my seams? And check with her first, or him. There's some guy long armors out there too, I'm sorry. But yeah, if you're concerned about that, it's still soft. It's super soft. See that? It's not stiff. And this is the one that's glue basted, right? So it's got a lot of give in it. I would be okay if that's what you did and you sent me your t-shirt quilt. Oh, Diana says she's bought the AK Trading thread. And she really likes it. Her Janome likes it as well. She's gotten 3 colors so far. Yeah, I've got, let's count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 colors. The most colors that I use. I mean, I would love to have all the colors of the rainbow, but primarily those are the 6 that I could possibly use in my t-shirt quilts. But yeah, I love that thread. I do. I love it a lot. I just want to go through my notes and make sure that I'm not missing anything. Dun, 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 dun. Advantages, disadvantages. I gave a list of different Pellon interfacings. Pros and cons of using it or not using it. I could be totally wrong, y'all. Things could go right back to the way they were next week. I could totally be wrong. I hope I am wrong. But if I'm not, I'm thinking, after talking with Pellon, who's in Florida, they're only in phase 2. I'm thinking it's going to be a good little while. I'm staying positive. A good little while before we get back to normal where we can order interfacing for our t-shirt quilts anytime soon, right? Unless we're lucky and happen to catch it at the right time, the right listing, the right distributor at the right time. If you happen to be in Joann's at the right time, you know, and you score on it. Other than that, you're going to be paying for it. I showed the current prices as well as prices from a couple weeks ago. Not much has changed. And so, yes, you can make your t-shirt quilts without the interfacing. You can absolutely do it. I think I said my number one tip for doing it is you have to have the patience. It's a little frustrating. It might take a little bit longer, but it's doable. You don't have to get frustrated because you can't find the interfacing. You don't have to pay an arm and a leg for it. I refuse to. I'm not doing it. I'm sorry, Pellon. I cannot support you right now. But you can't even buy directly from Pellon anyway. And people are buying it at these prices. It's flying off the shelves. They can't keep it in. What little is being made. So. Mimsy said hand quilting the quilt would be rough, she thinks. I think it might be too. But you don't have that extra layer of interfacing that your needle's going through either. So, I don't know. That might have pros and cons. I'm not a hand quilter. I wish I had the patience for it, but I just don't. It is one of my goals for this year, but this whole year has just been whacked. It is so crazy this year. Nothing right now could I have foreseen back in January. Even February, when I went to the Mid-Atlantic Quilt Festival, I didn't see this coming. They had just started talking about it. And yeah, it was just starting to come on the news. Who would have known? If I would have known at the quilt show, I would have stocked up. They have booths with interfacings in it. I would have stocked up. Who would have known in just a few short weeks, everyone would start experiencing the prices and the shortages. Crazy. Rhonda says, I have a t-shirt quilt to make for my oldest daughter with 5 kids. Shirts from when they were young. Need to rewatch your t-shirt quilt videos. Yeah, I have quite a few here on my channel. Block styles with sashing, and collage styles. Like all the blocks being different sizes. And binding videos for t-shirt quilts. Mary, I did talk about that in the very beginning of the video. So you can go back and watch that on the replay because I might go into it a little bit more. But just on the short, I cannot adjust my prices this far into 2020. I wish I could, but I'm going to tell you, I don't. Here's the thing, y'all. There are so many businesses going out of business. There are so many workers who are furloughed or completely unemployed. They've lost their job. In my area, on my pricing scale for my business with my quilts, I really feel like right now I'm kind of at the higher end. Like most people contact me for a t-shirt quilt. I don't hear back from them about 95% of the time. I get a lot more inquiries than I do commissions, because my prices are on the higher end for my area. And so I've just in the last couple of weeks come to realize I can't really raise my prices, and I cannot afford to pay interfacing prices the way they are. Fortunately, I was stocked up a little bit before going into this, right? But there will come a time if things don't change where I don't have interfacing. I cannot not change my prices and then pay what people are charging now for interfacing. I can't do that. So instead, alternatives. What can you do if you don't have interfacing? You can still make the quilt, right? It might take me a little bit longer, and it might not be as joyful or as quick. But I can do it, and I don't have to raise my prices. And that's just the option that I've taken with my business. And so every business is different. Maybe you do. Maybe in order to operate your t-shirt quilt business, maybe you do have to increase your prices. We're all different, right? I'm a home-based business. I don't have any employees. It's just me. And I have a studio here in my home. I don't have a lot of overhead. My machines are paid for. I'm in a very different position than a lot of other people, right? A lot of other businesses. And so I'm very blessed, and I don't forget ever, just like, thank you, Jesus, you know, that I'm in the position that I am, because so many people are not. But no, I'm not raising my prices, and those are the reasons why. Although on another note, not any of this related, I adjust my prices every January. So my prices 3 years ago were lower than they are now. And I think you always should be recapping, you know, looking over how much you spent in materials. Were you under where you should have been, and adjust your prices, right? Every January I do an assessment and my prices do go up to reflect my cost. Next year might be different unless things go back to normal, right? I haven't bought any interfacing at $10 a yard, and I refuse to. If things change altogether and this is more permanent, t-shirt quilts without interfacing, because you can do it, and maybe a serger. Investing in equipment instead of losing money on interfacing until things go back to normal. How awesome was the Mid-Atlantic? Oh, it's so much fun. I was there the first day of opening. Oh, I wish I would have known. It was a bit overwhelming and fun at the same time. That was from Michelle. I loved it. I wish I would have known you were going to be there. We probably The first day I was there, but it was in the afternoon, so we might have walked right by each other. Thank you, Miss Hazel. I enjoyed our time together when everything was shut down. Rhonda said, yes, our food is out of sight and now has going back up because they are opening up some. Wow. Gas prices. Yeah. Rhonda, you're so welcome. You're so welcome. Yes, Debbie, you are so right. Every business should adjust their prices periodically. You want to keep an eye. You know, one thing that I've noticed, and this is just a little extra tidbit, when I first started making t-shirt quilts on commission as a business, a few years ago, I was much slower to be accurate. Because I am kind of OCD with my quilts. I was a lot slower then. And now I can whiz through cutting out my blocks. And I can whiz through stabilizing them. I upgraded and got a heat press. That's so much faster, right? So now it doesn't take me half the time to make a quilt. It loads on the frame faster. I quilt it faster. Every part of it is faster now that I've had a couple years of everyday experience making quilts. I'm so much faster now. So, that's a benefit for me because my prices have increased, but it actually takes me less time to make them. So, you know, experience pays off, right? But the increase really affects, you know, my gas and driving to my suppliers and ordering stock at the current prices, all of that stuff. Ella says, I'm supposed to be getting a serger soon. I've never had one. Me neither, Ella, but it might be something that I look into upgrading to in the future, and then I'll have to watch a ton of YouTube videos about it and learn something new. But I think we should always be striving to learn something new, even if it's not a new machine or a machine like you've never tried before. We should be learning new techniques, you know, new quilt blocks, new, you know, methods, you know, maybe you've never tried a Y seam or a partial seam. Maybe look into doing some blocks with those, you know. I think we should always be trying to improve and to learn something new. There's so much out there that I don't know about, you know. I'm always excited, especially like when you go to those quilt shows. And you see all the quilts with so many different techniques. And then you walk through the vendors with all the different products. There's so much out there I haven't tried. So much I've tried that I loved and so much I tried that I was like, okay. No. But, yeah. I think we should always be trying to learn something new. Susan says, now that you've got a heat press, there's no interfacing. Isn't that the way it works? Yes, right? The cool thing about my heat press is I not only use it for putting the interfacing on my t-shirts, but I also do vinyl work, right, on t-shirts and stuff. And so there's that. I can use the heat press for that. And I was fortunate enough to be stocked up on interfacing before this all happened. So I have not run out yet. However, at this point, I interfaced all those t-shirts Monday. At this point, looking at my stock, I'm going to be real conservative about what I have left, right? Any of my future quilts coming up that are block styled, where all the blocks are the same size, I will be going without interfacing because I can do that easily. If it's a collage style where all the blocks are different sizes, I'm saving the interfacing because I need a little bit more control for the ones that have different size blocks. All my block style was sashing and just block styles, all the blocks the same size, row by row. No interfacing until all of this changes. So that's what I'm going to do to preserve what I have left for the little bit of a more difficult quilt. Dun, 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 dun. Michelle says, without interfacing, how do you control the t-shirt fabric from stretching on the long arm? And what about t-shirt fabric that is more open weave where you can see the needle holes? For those with a more of an open weave, you might want to back those with a cotton muslin, spray-based or glue-based, some cotton muslin underneath of that shirt before you quilt it, right? Without interfacing on the back side of your t-shirt quilt, imagine this, that size. And you already know, it's a little tug of war and a lot of manipulation when you load a normal quilt onto a long arm frame anyway, even if you're spray basting your quilt. I showed a video of that a couple years ago. It's a process. Even if you have interfacing on the backside, it's a process. Straighten it out here, go over here, straighten it out back and forth on the frame, right? Till you get it nice and straight. This has a lot more give. So my biggest recommendation is just go slow and be patient, because it's going to take a little bit longer. It's going to take a little bit longer, and you're not going to have as much control. So you're going to be fidgeting here, flatten it out, line it up, tug it here, tug it in the middle, tug it on this side, and whoops, you just untugged that side. You're just going to have to be more patient with it, but you can do it. I've done it. It just takes longer. Hello, Miss Vicky. Hello. You're welcome, everybody. You're welcome, Miss Barbara. Susan says, talk about being conservative with the interfacing. Are you asking me to talk about it? Because I just did. There's a little bit of a delay. Oh, meaning the size that you cut out of the interfacing. I talk about normally, under normal circumstances, when I use interfacing like it grows on trees, right? My normal everyday life. Let me switch you down to this camera here. My normal everyday life. Let's say I'm cutting out this block. This block was supposed to be 6.5 by 8.5, right? So when I was cutting out my interfacing, I cut it an inch bigger on both sides. So I would bring over my bolt like this. Ooh, this stuff. Interfacing. I bring it here and I cut it, 7 inches. I give myself an inch bigger because that's actually going to give you a little bit of wiggle room with your interface. I would cut it, but it's like cutting gold, right? I'm not going to cut it for the video, but you want to make it about an inch bigger all the way around. Yep, and I have a great big box underneath my table behind me of all of the scraps, because you can patch this stuff together, right? You can use every single bit of it. You don't want to throw any of it away. If you don't have a piece that's big enough, you could lay two pieces just like that and fuse it. You do want them to overlap slightly, because if you don't, the part that's not interfaced right in the middle, let's say you put two pieces here and there's a gap, that gap is going to act like this, and the rest of your block is going to have some body to it, and you might notice that. Make sure it overlaps, but yeah, you can use your scraps, and to save on interfacing, when I need a piece, I cut it an inch bigger, fuse it to the back, and then cut out my block, and that gives me about half an inch wiggle room in order to cut out my logo nice and straight, right? But yeah, save all your scraps too, for certain. Because you can use that like a puzzle on the back, you'd never know. Hazel, thank you. Let's see, let me go back to here. You like my shirt? This is the very first shirt I ever embroidered. You can't see it up close, and there's a good reason. I'm glad for that, because even though it looks kind of nice from this distance up close, that is not a pretty satin stitch in there, but it was my first shirt that I ever embroidered, so I'm very proud of it. Probably not going to sell them. Do you want a shirt that says Lisa Cape and Quilts on it? Let me know. Doing embroidery is not my favorite thing to do. It's not. Just reading through. Dun, 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 dun. I love that y'all chat in the chat box. It's one of the reasons why we're doing these lives, right? Gives everybody a chance to hang out with friends and have conversation. But he says, I would want a shirt with your logo on it. Really? Really? I always think that's, I don't know, that always sounds weird to me. Cheryl says, I do. Do you want me to make the shirt? Libby says, absolutely yes. All right, maybe we'll look into making shirts. Vicky, your hubby's sister came for rhubarb. Rhubarb pie, doesn't that sound delicious? I'm trying to be good, Vicky. Of course, I think rhubarb pie. It just might be rhubarb, right? I'm being good and eating cherry tomatoes instead of candy. Cherry tomatoes are good, though. With blue cheese and ranch. Aw, y'all are so sweet. Y'all are so sweet. So anybody here, join in halfway or towards the end, who might have questions. It's very well possible. We talked about it during the live. But if you have questions, now would be a great time to ask them, because I'm done switching back and forth and showing you stuff. Oh, yeah, Ella has a great point. I could make them with vinyl instead of embroidery. I have a love-hate relationship with that embroidery machine. Although, okay, so here's an update. Y'all know I don't love my embroidery machine. I wish I did. I would do more of it. But I did a quilt label for someone the other day, which I'm going to the post office as soon as we're done live. My post office is not close by. But I did that whole quilt label with some fancy little embroidery. There were 12 color changes in that embroidery, and not one thread break the whole time. I was sort of proud of my machine because, yeah, it was a great day. It's like, thank you. Are you going to do another live tutorial in the future? If so, what day and time? So far, the last couple weeks, I've been coming on live on Thursdays, 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. And that seems to be a pretty good time for me and a lot of people. There's really no perfect time, right, for everybody. But The last couple weeks has been Thursday, 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. I don't know what we're talking about next week. I have an idea, but we'll see. Teresa said, how much interfacing would it take for a laptop size quilt? All right, so let's do some math. Let's do some math, and I can't use my app because I'm using my phone to read the comments, but I have an app on my phone, Robert Kaufman app. It's great for figuring out stuff like this. You could put in the measurements of your quilt and then tell it the measurements of a yard of the interfacing you're using, and it'll tell you how many yards to get, right? It would do the math so quick for you. But let's say you're doing a block style lap size quilt and you're cutting your blocks. Let's say you're cutting them a 12 and a half inches by 12 and a half inches. You can cut two blocks out of 1 yard, right? Two blocks out of 1 yard. And you can... let's say at 12 by 12, you would need maybe 4 blocks across and 5 blocks down, 20 blocks for a lab size quilt. You might even go smaller, maybe. You need about 10 yards. The last time I heard someone found it at Joann's, they only let them buy 3 yards at a time. My Joann's is like 20 minutes north. And so that's 20 minutes to Joann's to find out I can get 3 yards. And then come home 20 minutes. And then hopefully the next time I go that way, I'll stop in there and get 3 more yards. Maybe I'll get lucky and there will be all the 10 yards I need and they'll let me get it. Who knows? But you need about 10 yards for a lap size quilt. But that's going to change depending on your block size, right? Lots of variables. The Mid-Atlantic Quilt Show is in February. It's usually the last weekend of February in Hampton, Virginia. Oh, Ella says, your embroidery machine is missing the threader, so you hate color changes. Mine has the threader. She's just, if you don't catch every little tension spot right while you're threading it, there's so many issues. She's so persnickety. If I get it threaded just right, I don't want to change the color. I don't want to take the thread out if I got it just right. But she went through 12 color changes the other day, and I was so pleased with that. Not one issue the whole time. I was so like, yeah, 2 squares per yard. A yard is 36 inches long, right? 36. And my favorite interfacing is 20 inches wide. So 20 by 36. You're going to have some extras left over. Don't get rid of them. You can piece it together. Yes, 20 inches wide, but if you buy a yard of it, it's 36 inches long. If you have 2 blocks that are 12 and a half by 12 and a half, that's 25 inches long by 12 inches, right? 12 by 25. You can get 2 blocks out of 1 yard. You're going to have a good section left over, right? Don't throw it away. Piece it together on some of your blocks, but 2 yards. Yeah, it's skinny. It's not as wide as a yard of cotton fabric, like 42 to 44 inches wide. Yeah, I wish it was. I showed some examples. There are some interfacings that are 60 inches wide. And so you could search for those. They're out there. They cost more. So... Teresa says, wow, I have some, but not that much. One thing, okay, so here's just my opinion. I'm sure there's people who would say something differently. And all that's how this whole video, that's how every video, I think, by every creator should be taken. It's my opinion, my point of view. But if you, Miss Teresa, use what you have, let's say you have 5 yards. So you do what you have, your t-shirts, half of them, let's say, with interfacing, and you run out and you have 10 more to do without interfacing. I think that's going to play a difference on how your quilt, when you're finished, is going to behave. The part with interfacing is going to have some body and some control to it. And then the part that's not interfaced is going to be maybe have more fullness in it because it's more stretchy, right, as you're quilting it or getting it finished. And it's going to be softer and more flowy. So if you don't have enough to do your quilt all the way through, I would almost recommend not using it at all and saving it for a project that's even smaller so that you have enough to use interfacing from start to finish. I think my opinion is that if you use it for some, you're going to be able to tell the difference in the areas where you didn't use it. So great to see everybody. I want to thank y'all for hanging out and spending some time with me this afternoon. So I'm hoping that in the future, because y'all, Pellon said we are so backlogged with calls and voicemails every day. Their emails, there's like a backlog of them. And she said, to be fair to everyone, we're handling it at first come, first serve with emails and responding to voicemails and stuff like that. They're inundated with questions. When are you going to have more, you know, when are you going to have more? And they're short staffed. I have been inundated with the same kinds of questions because I teach about, you know, t-shirt quilts and give tips on ways to make them. And so hopefully this video has answered a lot of the questions. If not, and you're not catching us on the live, jump down to the comment section, or even if you come back and revisit this and then have a question later, you can ask it down in the comment section. Vicky says, I have never made a t-shirt quilt, and a realtor that brought prospective buyers to our house saw our long arm and asked me if I would make her one for her daughter. I said I didn't think so. I've always had, you know, this is kind of my perspective on talking to so many people. You either really love making t-shirt quilts or you really hate making t-shirt quilts, right? There's some in between. There's some in between, but you either really love it and you have a passion for it, so you're willing to put up with stuff like not having interfacing or the extra hassle that takes, you know. You're willing to put up with making the t-shirt quilt because you love it so much, or you just don't like making it at all. No part of it do you enjoy. So there's us on all spectrums, but mostly you either love it or you hate it. Is it that, Miss Vicky, that you just don't want to make it, or you feel some reason you can't make it? I think there's a difference. Like, you just don't want to do it, or for some reason you feel like I would do it, but for some reason I can't. Oh, so you say because you've never made one, you would hate to ruin the blocks. Yeah, well, you know what? It's so much pressure when you're making it for someone else, right? My very first t-shirt quilt was a customer's quilt. I was a nervous wreck. That part does get easier. The more confident you get. So what I recommend to a lot of people is go to the thrift shop and buy some t-shirts that cost you like 10 cents. You know, our Goodwill, you pay by the pound. So you can get 20 t-shirts if they're light, you know, and you don't throw other stuff in your basket like I do. You can get 20 t-shirts really cheap, and you can experiment on those before you do someone else's, or pull some out of your closet that you haven't worn in forever and make a quilt with those first. Vicki says she feels like she might be able to do it. Yeah, and then you're not sure what to charge. There's all the spectrums, right? There's all the spectrums. Hazel said, would you say practice makes perfect with an embroidery machine? I think knowing the basics, like you need to know what kind of interfacing stabilizer to use when you're doing embroidery. So much of your results really depends on the stabilizer you're using. If you're not using the right stabilizer for your project, you're going to have so much frustration at the machine. So there's a learning curve on that. And then, you know, realizing that my machine doesn't like any of the other five other brands of thread that I've tried. It only likes one. And coming to the point to realize that, experimenting, will this work? Will this work? Was frustrating. So having that knowledge now makes my time at the embroidery machine is so much easier too, I think, you know. All of that experience and the trial and errors is so valuable. And the more knowledge you have about the basics and your machine, the easier time you're going to have doing embroidery. And that's my experience. Oh, Jeannie said she did a t-shirt quilt for her son. She said, I have to have patience with preparations. Yes, putting together the quilt was fine. Ooh, Ella's just cut up two wedding dresses for memory bears. Ooh, that sounds awesome. Yeah, Susan, go to the Goodwill and look for practice t-shirts. Amy says she's going to experiment with her husband's Georgia shirts. He has lots. Oh, he has a lot of faith in an old lady. It'll be my first. Amy, you'll have to let us know. Keep us updated on that. Keep us updated. If y'all are on, if you've just joined us, and maybe this is your first time watching, right? There's a group called the Creative Crew Group. It's a group that I host on Facebook. There's a link in the description box below. We're up to over 3,000 members, and it's really more just like family, and we share projects, and if we have questions, we post a picture, and there's lots of experience in that group. The members are so helpful, and they'll walk you through it, Amy. So if you're on Facebook, join it. If you haven't already, join us on the Creative Crew Group. We would love to be there to support you in your first quilt, first t-shirt quilt. Debbie said, when I did a t-shirt quilt, I had no idea what I was doing. It scared me to death. Me too, Debbie. My first ones, I was nervous. I was scared I was going to mess up their treasured, lifelong favorite t-shirt that they've had since second grade. I was so scared of that. I'm not nervous about it anymore, though. Roxanna, yeah, we're just finishing up. We're just chit-chatting and really chit-chatting at this point. You'll have to come back on the replay because I went through, I felt like I did a term paper research before this video. I gave preferred interfacings and really my thought process on why there's a shortage. I gave tips on needles and thread and starch, glue basting versus pin basting, two different stitches you can join your quilt blocks together if you're making a t-shirt quilt without interfacing. I called Pellon, so I'll tell you about that conversation, and she gave me a list of interfacings that you can look for, and she told me how to get to a list of Pellon distributors. So I shared all of that, and there was some other stuff in there too, I forget. Mimi said, may I ask what stabilizer is used for embroidery machines? Wow, there are so many. There's water-soluble stabilizers. There is tear-away stabilizers. There's cut-away stabilizers. There's sticky paper stabilizers. There's lightweight and heavyweight and light. There's fusible stabilizers. There's spray basting, floating versus hooping. Oh my goodness, it was so much to learn. Thank you, Cheryl. It's like a mind dump of information. I really think to get it all, you might have, you know, I'm so glad you were here for the live, but you might have to revisit, like come back, what was that list from Pellon? Okay, and write them down, you know, come back to it. Maybe it'll be a month from now when you start your quilt and you'll be like, what stitch did she use? And you can come back to it. So it was a lot jam-packed in there. Would you use any of those? Would any of those work for the t-shirts? Nope. Nope. Any of your sew-in stabilizers, like a tear-away for embroidery, no, it's not sticky. You don't fuse it onto the backside. The interfacing that we use for t-shirt quilts actually fuses to the t-shirt material. Tear-away stabilizer, well, there's some that are sticky. They stick to it, but it's a paper and it's sticky. No, and it's expensive. It's so expensive. Can you imagine cutting 30 12-inch blocks? This is not even 12 inches. It's 6 by 8. That would cost a small fortune, and it would be so difficult to pull the sticky back off. Most tearaways, you float under or you hoop in your embroidery machine, and then you stabilize the fabric to the stabilizer. So, yeah, it's totally different. Totally different. Oh, Ella has a great suggestion. You could join some good embroidering Facebook groups and let them know what you're making, and they will let you know what kind of stabilizer to use. I use Embrilliance to do my embroidery work. So I open up my file on my computer in Embrilliance. I bring in my font and I do my words. And then I might have a cute picture I bring in, and then I send it over to the embroidery machine, right? But Embrilliance will look at your project. Let's say it's a memory bear with a cute little saying, and you're doing embroidery of the cute little saying on some fabric. Embrilliance will say, okay, what type of fabric are you using? And you put in cotton, light cotton. It looks at how many stitches are in your design, and the fabric you're using, and the thread, and it'll say, okay, we recommend you use a medium to heavyweight cutaway stabilizer, or we recommend that you use a lightweight stabilizer, tearaway. So that's really great about Embrilliance, is they give you recommendations in the software. But yes, I belong to a couple of Embrilliance groups on Facebook, and they are so helpful, so helpful. You can tell when it gets ready, time to go, I start messing with my hair. I just noticed that. So, I just want to thank everybody for spending time with me. I know that I talk, and I do know that I might have missed your comment or your questions during the live, and it took so much for me to make sure I wasn't missing anything. So, I apologize if that happened. I intentionally would never ignore anybody. But yes, thank you so, so much for hanging out with me this afternoon. It's so great to see your names pop up in the live chat. Janice, you're so welcome. I've been so proud of you watching your pictures. You're doing so good, Janice. I've been proud of you. All right. Okay, everybody, until next Thursday, as far as I know, next Thursday, we're good. 12 o'clock noon. Ooh, just letting you know, in case you missed the post, if you're on Creative Crew Group, we're doing a Zoom tonight at 8 o'clock. I'll post the link on Creative Crew Group. And until I see y'all next week, let me find the right screen to be on. There we go. Until I see you next week, I don't know what we're doing. I have an idea, but I don't want to say in case I change my mind. I'm a little wishy-washy like that, so I don't want to say. But yes, I'll see you next Thursday. Thank you so, so much for watching. A great big thumbs up would be so helpful, y'all. If you could thumbs up on your way out of YouTube, that would help me so much. I love you. I'll see you next week. Bye.